All over the house while you're standing, all over the house. Lift your hands all over the house. I need you to open up your mouth and begin to worship him. Worship him in spirit. Worship him in truth. I need somebody to worship him from the depths of your heart. Come on, that's it. That sounds good. Worship, 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 worship. Worship, 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 worship. Hallelujah. Come on, we were created to worship. Come on, let's join in with the angels. Somebody begin to cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Come on, that's it for a few more moments. A few more moments. Come on, there's such a beautiful sound, such a beautiful sound. Come on, everybody can't worship. Come on, everybody can't worship. Come on, worship is more than clapping your hands. Come on, worship is more than even shouting. Come on, worship has to come from your heart. Come on, you have to have experienced Christ to be able to worship. You've had to have gone through something to be able to worship. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, right now in this atmosphere while God's presence is here, I need you just to lean over and grab the hand of the person standing next to you. Come on, if they're not too mean, I need you to grab the hand of the person next to you. Come on, in this atmosphere right now, begin to pray, not only for yourself, but begin to pray for your neighbor. Begin to pray for your neighbor. Come on, that's it, that's it. Come on, that's it, that's it, that's it. Come on, we're worshiping a holy God. We're worshiping a holy God. Come on, we're worshiping a God that deserves reverence. Come on, he deserves glory. He deserves honor. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He's holy, he's holy, he's holy. I can't come in his presence and not worship him. He's too pure, he's too holy, he's too righteous. On my best day, my righteousness, not my self-righteousness, but my righteousness. The best thing that I have to offer God is as of a filthy rag. I have to worship him, I have to worship him. Come on, I feel like Isaiah. I'm a man of unclean lips, unclean hands. When I stand in his presence, I love you so much, God. I love you. I love you so much. I love you. I love you. I love you, God. I love you. I glorify your holy name. I glorify your holy name. I bless your holy name. I bless your holy name. Why don't you release that hand and why don't you put your hands together now one more time and give God a shout of praise. Come on, give God a shout of praise. Give God a shout of praise. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. He's worthy of all the praise, the glory, and the honor. We honor him tonight. So good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. The old song said he didn't have to let any of us live, but it's a joy to be in his service just one more time. Little do we know, this might be our last time. Nobody knows what tomorrow holds. It's a joy to be in his house. While you're standing, you can grab your Bibles. Such a privilege and an honor to be here with this wonderful assembly, wonderful church. I say it this morning, once again, I do give honor to the Graham family, Pastor and First Lady Graham. Let's make some noise for them one more time. Come on, let's make some noise. Let's make some noise. Come on. Let's give God praise for the man and woman of God of this house. Amen, 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 amen. Amen. We honor them. As I said, it's been a privilege. Hospitality has been top-notch, first class. Amen. It's a privilege to be here once again with the Graham family. Also, Minister Omar Williams. Amen. What an awesome job he has done coordinating this event once again. We honor him. Thank God for him. Appreciate the invitation to be back. So many friends, and I hesitate to even start calling names, but amen, it's so good to see so many of my good friends. Pastor Omar Jolly, we've been friends for so many years. So good to see him in the house. Amen. Thankful for his friendship. We've been friends for many years. It's good to see him in the house. And Brother Miguel Garrick is in the house. Amen. We honor him. We thank God for him. Amen. And Brother Damon Stubbs has been preaching here this week, been preaching the house down. Honor Brother Damon Stubbs. Amen. Amen. Had a chance to meet him in Louisiana a few years ago. Amen. Glad we were able to connect. Brother Norton, we honor him as well. We give God praise for this man of God. It's good to be with him. Also, Brother Tayo Gill. Amen. We honor you, sir. We thank God for you. Amen. The book of Philippians, chapter 3, if you would allow me, to slow it down just a little bit tonight. I do understand, I've been preaching long enough, I do understand that this is the last service of this particular conference. And I do understand that we are supposed to, in no uncertain terms, go to the mountain, amen, and have a good time and carry it around in a purse. If you drive long enough, I don't know how it is here in New York, but where I'm from in Georgia, if you drive long enough, you will find a dog either sitting in his owner's lap, acting like he's driving with his head out the window and tongue flapping. Dogs have become so admired that they have even obtained the title of man's best friend. But in the Bible, dogs were not man's best friend. Matter of fact, in the Bible days, they were not even considered to be pets. Dogs in the Bible, ladies and gentlemen, they were not domesticated. They would be seen on the street barking at people passing by, and they would be howling all night. Dogs, they would eat anything, heaps and lumps of trash. They would go into garbage cans like scavengers, and they would even eat other dead animals. Let me give you some Bible. Revelation chapter 22, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Here it is, verse 15. For without are dogs. Everybody shout dogs. And sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. Did you hear that? Dogs are mentioned in the same category as a murderer and a whoremonger. Dogs were considered unclean animals. Let me give you some more Bible because I'm going to be very practical tonight. So let me be spiritual up front. Matthew chapter 7, verse 6. The Bible says, give not that which is holy. Am I in the Bible? Unto the dogs. Solomon, he gives us clearer understanding in Proverbs chapter 26, verse 11, when he says, as a dog returneth to his vomit, so a fool returneth to his folly. You remember in Mark chapter 7, verse 27, when the Syrophoenician woman came to Jesus because her daughter was vexed with an unclean spirit. Jesus told her, it's not right that I give the children's bread to dogs. Dogs were not respected in Bible days. Bible days, dogs were not seen as positive or familial additions, but rather they were discarded as unclean. They were discarded to be filthy and to be sinful. But in our text in Philippians 3:2, Paul, he warns us to beware or to watch out for those dogs. Notice, he wasn't talking about people in the world. He was talking to the church. There's dog spirits in the church. The Apostle Paul, he was not literally talking about four-legged dogs, creatures walking around the church building, but is referring to the dog-like spirits that sometimes can get in people. Y'all quiet early. God gave me 8 particular dog spirits that are in the church as a whole today, and I'm going to share with you on what kind of dogs to watch out for in the church. The first type of dog that you need to watch out for is a neighborhood dog. Everybody shout neighborhood dog. You see, a neighborhood dog, ladies and gentlemen, is of no breed, is of no particular heritage. He's not going anywhere in his life. He is not doing anything that is productive. He's just a neighborhood dog who always lies around in somebody's yard and looking for a free handout. In no uncertain terms, he is, if you allow me just to be blunt and forward tonight, he is a lazy dog. He has no motivation to do anything but chill. I can remember growing up, there was a neighborhood dog that we would always see in our neighborhood, and my family took this neighborhood dog in, and this dog, his breed, he was supposed to only be 10 pounds, but he was about 30-plus pounds. I can remember as a child leaving for school, and this dog would be lying on the floor, and I would return home 8 hours later, and he was still laying in the same spot. You know some people like that? Don't say amen. Just look straight ahead. Amen. He would walk up 3 stairs and then take a 10-minute break. He would walk up 3 more, and when he finally got to the top as if he achieved something, he took a nap. He was a lazy, good-for-nothing dog. If you excuse me, I'm going back home tomorrow. This is true with some people. They're neighborhood Christians. They don't want to do anything but come to church, if that. Please don't ask them to worship. Please don't ask them to sing. Please don't ask them to teach a Bible study. You better not ask them to pay their tithes or to take out the trash. They're no service to the pastor. They're no service to the church or their community. They're just comfortable. They're just complacent and content to sit around and watch. All they do, neighborhood dogs, is sit around and gossip with other neighborhood dogs. Gossip about the visitors. Gossip. It's going to be quiet. Ain't no shouting going probably tonight. I'm sorry. Sit around and talk about the saints and talk about the leadership. They have no destiny. They have no ministry. They have no purpose in life. They're just lazy. They're just messy. They go from church to church, house to house, ministry to ministry, looking for other neighborhood dogs who will agree in their rebellion. You got to watch out for neighborhood dogs. Y'all ain't gonna like me tonight. The second dog that you need to watch out for is a pit bull. Everybody shout pit bull. I'm just gonna talk tonight. Pit bulls, they are mad. They are mean and aggressive dogs. Have you noticed that pit bulls are mean for no reason? Pit bulls are mad with everything and everybody. And sadly, we have pit bull Christians in the church. Mad because the choir won't sing their favorite song. Mad because the preacher won't preach from their favorite text. Mad because the deacons won't acknowledge them. If you hang around pit bulls long enough, they'll make you go mad. Pit bulls, they come to church and they sit here mumbling and grumbling all through the service. They frown and they turn sideways when somebody is up there they don't like or approve of. They walk around church with a frown on their face. And you know what I'm talking about? Some of you can already see people already got their fists balled up. They got their lips poked out. And ain't nobody did nothing to them. They just mad for no reason. The problem with the church is that we have too many pit bulls in the church.
We're supposed to be humane. We're supposed to be compassionate people. Once again, I don't know how it happens up here in New York, but back home in Georgia, pit bulls are always in the news for biting or killing babies. Could it be that the church does not grow as fast as it should because we have too many, y'all ain't got to say nothing to me in this house. You can sit there and look at me all night. There's too many pit bull Christians in the house of God that keep biting and killing our babies, that keep biting and killing our new converts. Every time somebody gets saved, you don't give them time to grow before you just bite and kill their testimony. A couple of years ago, I had to deal with this even in my local church back home in Atlanta. There was a young woman who came. Matter of fact, she was one of my friends, a girlfriend. She came to church and she got baptized and she received the gift of the Holy Ghost. To God be the glory. And I'll never forget, she was in the bathroom. She was changing clothes and putting her normal clothes back on. But while she was in the bathroom, one of our pit bulls met her in the bathroom. I know y'all don't have them up here. They're just in our church back home. One of our pit bulls went behind that new convert. And as she was redressing and putting her clothes back on, this pit bull said, "Now that you've gone down in the water, honey, you can stop dressing like a hooker and be a real woman of God." Pit bull. Sad to say, that young woman left our church and never came back because a pit bull got a hold to her. You see, pit bulls have become such a problem in Georgia that they're even thinking about making a law to ban them from even being pets. I know this may be extreme, but could the church possibly be a better place to worship and to pray and to fellowship? Maybe if we banned all the pit bull Christians, all the people with those nasty attitudes, those treacherous, and maybe you can't say man because I'm talking to you. You better watch out for those pit bulls. You better make sure you don't connect yourself with people who always got something negative to say, always want to put their mouth on the man of God, the woman of God, and his children. You better distance yourself from people who always trying to bite on God's children. I know y'all want to shout tonight. Maybe next time. Maybe next time. Third dog, let me hurry. Y'all already get rid of me already. Sorry, I'm sorry to disappoint you tonight. The third dog you need to watch out for is a bird dog. Yeah, that's old school. Your grandma know what I'm talking about. Your granddad know what I'm talking about. Everybody shout bird dog. A bird dog, maybe you didn't understand that, they're sometimes called a hunting dog. Yeah, they're used to retrieve birds. Notice, a bird dog does not kill the bird himself. The bird dog just points and sets them up. Uh-oh. He doesn't physically kill the bird himself. He has it done. All right? When the hunter gives the sign, the hunting dog will jump in the bush and the birds fly up in the air, and the hunter then will say thank you and shoot them down. We have some bird dog Christians. They sit back and point to who's dating who. Who made this mistake last week? Where is so-and-so? None of your business. How they driving that car? They don't make that much money. How you know? God could have gave him a raise last week. How you know? I want to sit back and point out everybody else. You see, they don't kill you, but they have you killed. Okay, let me give you some Bible, because y'all think I'm just too practical and too pragmatic tonight. Let me give you some Bible. Judas was a bird dog. Judas didn't kill Jesus. He pointed him out with a kiss and said, "Now, this is who I'm talking about. Now kill him." Delilah was a bird dog. Yes, 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 she was. Delilah did not kill Samson. She just got him to lay his head on her lap and tell her his secret. And then she snapped and had him killed. I don't know who I'm preaching to on this Sunday night, but you better be careful with who you share your personal business with. Y'all ain't gonna push me tonight. You gotta be careful with who you indulge and divulge and tell all of your personal business, because sometimes Satan will diabolically and strategically place people in your life who it seems on the outside they are trying to be your prayer partner. They ain't praying for you. They don't care about your livelihood. They're just trying to retrieve enough information so they can go back and have you killed. Be careful with who you share information with. Because little do you know, you could be sharing your private stuff with a bird dog. Then you got the nerve to wonder, how everybody know my business? Yeah, then you got folks coming up to you acting as if they're prophesying. They ain't prophesying. Coming down to the altar, whispering in your ear. No, you told your business to somebody, and they got back around the rumor mill, and now they want to be deep and super spiritual prophesying. You ain't prophesying. You're lying. You got to be careful with who you share your information with. I know we're in the 21st century, a technological generation and age, but why does everybody share personal, intimate information, even on social media? But then get mad when everybody know your business. How you know my business? You just put it on Facebook. We all like to share things in our life, but if you and your spouse are fighting, don't put it on Facebook. Oh, y'all pray for me, child. Me and my wife going at it. Seriously? Them folks ain't going to pray for you. All they going to do is screenshot it and send it to everybody in the world and say, pray for so-and-so. Their marriage is about to mess up. And then little do you know, there's somebody who secretly wants your wife and your husband anyway. And all you did was just set the information up. Keep your personal business to yourself.
Okay. Oh, this may be my last time here. God bless you. Y'all all right? I feel good. Ain't nobody shouting. Ain't nobody dancing. I feel good tonight.
All right, here we go. I got to hurry. The fourth dog
you need to watch out for is a poodle. Let the church shout poodle. How many people own a poodle in here or know somebody that own a poodle? Oh, are y'all scared to raise your hands now? Y'all doing it quick. Amen. Yeah, let's talk about this poodle spirit in the church. You know, a poodle is probably the cutest dog. Poodles are show dogs. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me tonight. Ain't nobody y'all was high-fiving me this morning. What happened tonight, y'all? I ain't got nobody on the organ. My musician don't ran out. I ain't got nobody. Poodles need special attention. Poodles need special grooming. They just can't be groomed anyway. Yeah, they got to have special pedicures. I'll never forget at a dog park a few years ago, we saw a poodle with pink toenail polish on a dog. What kind of mess is that? Toenail polish. Who has time to do that? But that's a poodle for you. It's a poodle. A poodle, yeah, she's so pretty. She's fine. But the only thing she's good for is to look at. You got to watch out for those poodle Christians. And you can tell who the poodles of the church are because they come in every single Sunday during the middle of the service with a new outfit on, acting like they didn't know that service start the same time every Sunday. And they walk like a cat on a walk. Sit yourself down. I ain't trying to see you. I'm trying to see the glory. Sit yourself down.
They're too cute to worship. They're too cute to dance. They're, I just got my nails done. I just got my toes did. I can't worship. I can't break no nail. They're too cute to run the aisle. I'm talking about y'all brothers too. They don't come to church for no other reason but to be seen. They can't mess up their hair. They can't mess up their suit. They can't mess up their dress. Their high heels are too high. Their pants are too skinny. I ain't afraid of none of you. Yeah. They just come to church to look good. You see, that poodle spirit will have you in the mirror getting ready for church for 3 hours, but at the altar for 3 minutes. You see, poodles spend too much time taking selfies doing worship than they do worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Nobody goes to heaven on looks. There's nothing wrong with looking good. Please iron your clothes. Please put lotion on your ashy elbows. Please get your hair done, but don't let it stop you from getting in the I ain't going there tonight. God ain't coming back for your looks. He's coming back for your soul. Ma'am, I don't care how cute you are. Sir, I don't care how handsome you are. You're not that cute and you're not that handsome where you can't give God praise, where you can't debase yourself sometimes, where you can't humble yourself sometimes and let some sweat fall off your face. Kick your shoes off sometime. I don't care how much your suit costs. When you get finished sweating out, take it to the cleaners. But when you're in the house of God, I will dance like David danced. I will shout like David shout.
Okay. We got to get to the point. We have to get to the point. When I come to church, I'm coming to bless the Lord. I understand, when we come to church, we're not coming to see you. We're not coming to see your flesh. We're not coming to see your body. We see enough of that in the world. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. We see enough of that in the world. We see enough of that in the supermarket. We see enough of that on billboards. And if any place we should be able to come and be safe, we shouldn't come to church and have to close our eyes. We should not have to come to church and have to overlook people because of what you got on. Nobody comes to church when you don't suppose to come to church looking for flesh. God says, I'm looking at your heart. I'm looking at your spirit. It's okay to dress it up. But whenever you can't move, you can't say nothing, you can't shout, you can't dance, you can't run, you can't fall on your knees in prayer because you don't want to mess up, you know, your pants and your suit. There is something wrong with your priorities, because when we die, we can't take this stuff with us. This ain't nothing but rags, honey. This ain't nothing but trash. All this stuff is going to stay here. God says, I'm reaching for your spirit. Told a young man in my church a few weeks ago, I said, I know it's summertime, man. I said, I know you're traveling, man. I said, man, your shirt's so tight, man, we can see your six-pack through your shirt, man. I said, you're killing me, man. I said, we always preach to the women all the time, but these guys, we got to preach to the brothers now. Back then, anytime you talked about this stuff, the brothers crossed their legs and said, get them, get those women. But now you got to deal with the brothers, because the brothers are almost as immodest as the women are now, with the pants and with the tight shirts. You got to understand, brother, when we come to church, we didn't come to see the Incredible Hulk. We've come to see an incredible God who deserves incredible praise. I'm glad you're working out, but loosen it up a little bit.
Okay. A lot of y'all young people looking for spouses, and you're looking at the wrong thing. You're trying to see how long her legs are instead of seeing how long can she worship before she got to look at the mirror again. Looking at the wrong stuff. Got a six-pack but can't pray for 6 minutes. Looking at the wrong stuff. Because trust me, young person, when you get married, when you say I do, and when trials and tribulations and tragedy hit your life, that six-pack ain't going to mean nothing to you. That Coke bottle shape ain't going to mean nothing to you. You better make sure you find somebody who know how to grab your hand and not take you to the bedroom, but take you to the prayer room and say, let's get down and pray. Let's go to church and worship. You got to stop looking at the wrong stuff.
I tell young people all the time, I told somebody this the other day, it's amazing. Young lady, you talking to this young man on the phone. Here's the way you get him. Let me give you a secret. Here's the way you get him. You're dating and you're talking to this young man on the phone and he starts to get a little runchy. Well, that's a red flag right there anyway. But he gets a little runchy and say, hey, baby, well, why don't you tell me what you're wearing? Tell me what you got on. You ought to tell him. You want to know what I'm wearing? You ought to say I'm wearing a helmet of salvation.
I wish I can talk in here. I'm wearing a breastplate of righteousness. He gonna say, no, you know what I'm talking about. No, I got my loins. No. What? No. I got my loins girded about with. Y'all ain't say nothing to me. I got my feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Matter of fact, I got my shield of faith and my sword of the spirit. You ought to tell that no good perverted joker, I got the whole armor of God on. You want to know what I'm wearing from sunup to sundown? I got the whole armor. I'm covered.
Watch out for those. Watch out for those poodles. I gotta hurry. Watch out for those poodles. The fifth dog you need to watch out for is a Shih Tzu. Listen. I wish they would have put it on the screen because I didn't cuss. I promise you. It's a dog. I promise you. S-H-I-H space, capital T-Z-U. If I'm not mistaken, I think the Grahams got a Shih Tzu. Amen. I'm really about to get in trouble now. But don't worry, I'm right there with you. Amen. All right, this is the fifth dog spirit you better watch out in the church. I parallel and I put them together because the Shih Tzu, he's not as bad as the poodle. But he's in the same class. He's in the same category as the poodle. If you don't know, Shih Tzus are very small. They're pretty and adorable. Years ago, when my wife and I first got married, she wanted a dog, so I did some research. She really wanted a Shih Tzu. I was trying to get her something else, but that's what she wanted. So happy wife, happy life is what they say. That's what they say. Sometimes I don't know. Amen. Please don't tell her that. I bought her a Shih Tzu, y'all, and like I do with anything, even buying a dog, I'm not going to just buy a dog. I'm going to do my due diligence, and I'm going to research them. After all my research on Shih Tzus, I found out that they are good for nothing. I'm talking to myself. I got one, a black and white one. His name Oreo. And I don't miss him. But there was something that stuck out to me in my research of this Shih Tzu. It said, and I can testify, that a Shih Tzu, they crave and demand human attention. Am I right about it? And if they do not receive enough human attention, they get separation anxiety. A dog. Did you hear that? A dog. They get separation anxiety. You know I'm coming. There are a lot of Shih Tzu Christians in the church. They crave attention. They demand attention. And if they don't get enough of it, they get separation anxiety. Something ain't right. I don't feel loved here. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. And God is saying, hey, I'm right here. Yeah, something just don't feel right. They thirst for attention. If you don't use them, they get mad. Brother Omar, you might have missed some names when you were calling all those names out. And if there's a Shih Tzu in the crowd, they're ticked off right now. They don't even know if they're coming back next Sunday.
This is my last conference. Do all that slaving in the kitchen, you don't call my name? I don't know who you are, but maybe you're out there somewhere. Yeah, don't use me. Got the nerve to overlook me and overlook my gift and disrespect my family and don't applaud me. And I'm the biggest tithe payer in the church. You don't pat me on the back. I don't see my plaque. I don't see my name on the wall. You ain't got me sitting on stage. Why you didn't pull me up there with the other preachers? Shizu Christian. Yeah. If you don't shake their hand every service, they leave the church because they didn't get enough attention. We need more attention on God than we do us. Whatever happened to the days where people came to church, check this out, for God? I know that's not popular anymore. We got to do everything we can to get people to church. What happened to the days where people just came to church for God and not what you could do for them? Boy, y'all may not have me back. God bless y'all. It's been good, New York. God bless you. Watch out for those Shih Tzus. All right, the sixth dog you need to watch out for is a bulldog. Everybody shout bulldog. A bulldog is not an energetic dog. I don't think I've ever seen a bulldog jump or run. Bulldogs, they are not known to be high energy or playful pets. They just have that long, droopy face that shows no enthusiasm or emotion. It's so many bulldog Christians that come to church with long faces. And the Bible says, serve the Lord with gladness. How do you expect to win your world and bring them to church when your face is always long? Never smile. Look at your neighbor and smile right now. Some of you can't even do that. Look at your neighbor and smile. Smile. Smile at him real good. Bulldog Christians, they always look down and out. Even when something good happens to them, they still look like they lost their best friend. What's wrong with you? I just got a promotion. Why are you looking like that? It's just 15 people got the Holy Ghost. Should have been 20. Man, Brother Stubbs preached the house down Friday. He preached too long. I don't know if they said that. I don't know if they said that. I ain't trying to start no rumor there. I don't know. Man, Brother Wideman did good. I can't wait till he go back to Atlanta. Joke. I don't know who you think he is up here. Just always long face. Always got something wrong. Never run, never shout, never dance, never pray. Just sit there looking like a Georgia bulldog. There was something I noted while studying a bulldog church. It said that a bulldog can get so attached to his yard that he does not move or leave it until a human companion moves or leaves. Let's connect the dots. There's a lot of bulldog Christians who are so attached to their pew. Lord forbid somebody sit in your pew. You bought the pew. You built this church yourself. And they got the nerve, the unmitigated gall to sit in your pew. How dare them, you sinner. Man, I know it don't. That's why y'all laugh, because it don't happen up here. Y'all got it going on in New York. Wish y'all come to Georgia and help us out. Y'all got it going on. We had to deal with this at my local church a few months ago. This individual, my Lord, he's a mix of a pit bull and a bulldog. Good God Almighty, he ain't no joke. He's going to tear you to pieces if he get a hold to you. Had the nerve. There was a visitor that came to our church and blessed us with their presence. But this bulldog, God bless his soul, went up to the lady and said, "This is my pew." That's how you talk for real, y'all. "This is my pew." You got to understand, there was other open seats. But because he had been sitting there for 20 years and he paid good tithe, "This is my pew." Sad to say, We tried to do damage control. We ain't seen a lady ever since. Nobody owned anything. And especially if a visitor comes in and needs somewhere to sit down, if you are a seasoned saint, you ought to get your carnal carcass up and stand up for the rest of the service to let somebody else receive the gospel just like you did. I'm going to preach it like I feel it. The stuff eats me up. It's the small stuff like this. We want to talk about the fornication. It's the small stuff like this that's killing babies in the church. My dad and I was fired up. This your pew. This my pew. Take your tithes and, Lord help me, let me move on. Bulldogs. I'm okay. Bulldogs. Y'all all right still? Bulldogs. I know some of y'all brought y'all dancing shoes tonight, huh? Take them off. Let's just talk for a little bit. Bulldogs. They are so attached to their pew. You remember what I said? The bulldog does not move unless his human companion moves first. Christians are so attached to their pew that it does not matter how good the worship service is. It does not matter how good the preaching is. It don't matter if God come down here and slap you in your face. They are not going to move until another human companion moves. They're not going to say anything until Susie or Billy says something. We got to get to the place that when we come to church, even if nobody else is saying or doing nothing, you got to learn how to get the party started yourself. If you go home from church and say, I didn't receive nothing from God, don't blame it on any other human companion. Blame it on yourself. If you got to worship by yourself, do it by yourself. If you got to shout, do it by yourself. If nobody come to this altar, you come to the altar by yourself. Stop looking to the left and the right, waiting on somebody to go before you.
Okay. All right. Number 7. We're almost there, y'all. The 7th dog you need to watch out for. I told you there were 8 of them. There's a plethora of dogs I could talk about, but for sake of time, there's 8 tonight. The 7th dog you better watch out for is a coon dog. Young people, what? 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 Yeah. You know what a coon dog is? Yeah. It's in his name. That's exactly what he does. He is trained to catch raccoons. Yeah. Uh-huh. Look it up. They catch raccoons. But check this out. If you study a coon dog only does his work at nighttime. Coon dog can't work in the day. Like the old song said, the freaks come out at night. Yeah. Let's talk now. A coon dog Christian comes in the church Sunday morning and falls asleep before the offering is taken up. Not because he's been out working. Yeah, but he's been out prowling all night long. They act normal during the daytime. But as soon as it gets dark and nobody is looking, they become a totally different person. Say amen before you give yourself away. At church, they act spiritual and holier than thou. But in the wee hours of the night, they're downloading pornography on their smartphone. They're dancing on Sunday morning, but Monday night, they're watching ungodly movies on Netflix. Yeah, they dance, they shout, they sing, they teach, they preach, they pay their tithes, but yet they fornicate, they talk dirty on the phone, they're streetwalkers. They do all of their business in the wee hours of the night. You got to watch out for those coon dogs. All right, y'all not going to like this 8th one. That's why I saved it for last, so I can run out of here. I left Pastor Graham's office unlocked. I'm running out of here after this 8th one. I promise you. We ain't got a fellowship. God bless you. The 8th dog you better watch out for as I get ready to take my seat. The 8th dog you better watch out for is a dog in heat.
I promise you. I understand pulpit etiquette. You got to clutch your pearls. It's okay. It's okay. Eighth dog. You better watch out for as a dog. Can I make it plain? In no uncertain terms, I know some of y'all don't like me, but I love y'all. It's okay. In no uncertain terms, there are a lot of church folk who are in heat. They're saved, but struggle with lust. They're saved, but struggle with immoral desires. That's why a person who is promiscuous is called a dog. A person that's promiscuous, a person that sleeps around, is called a dog. Now, I'm talking about boys. I'm talking about girls, men, women, single, divorced, engaged, married. I'm talking about young and old. Because even if you're 70 and 80, if you got flesh, sometimes we all struggle. Let me give you a sign to let you know that a dog is in heat. They say that if a female dog is in heat, it says that you may begin to notice some stray dogs around your house. Every now and then, back home, I get a little suspicious when I start seeing a lot of young men hanging around my church, and not one of them is getting saved. It's always a red flag to me. I love everybody that comes to church looking for God. But you've been there 6 months, a year, you ain't even seeking. You're just hanging out. Just looking around, trying to see what's going on. Could it be that they have strayed our way because they've been led to believe that some of our sisters are in heat? Y'all ain't got to say nothing to me. The old adage is, what my mama told me, maybe your mama didn't tell you this, if you lie down with the dog. Your mama told you that too, huh? Amen. Thank God for mama. You're going to rise up with fleas. We have some church folk that are in heat. I know this is uncomfortable, but we got to deal with the elephants in the room. I don't even want to preach this. I want to hoop and holler a little bit. I want to scream and show you how good of a preacher I am. I really do. I know I'm messing up. I know. We got to deal with the real issues. Some people are just so messed up. Anything and everything turns them on. Okay, I'm walking a tightrope, but I'm here. Some people, you can't even say hello to them. Uh-oh. Without them thinking, you like them. All I did was say hello. And you come to church next week with a wedding dress? I just said, God bless you. You can't even walk past some people without them saying, that's the one, that's the one, that's the one, that's the one. No, the pastor just said, go greet your brother, greet your son. I'm just greeting you because they're so driven by it. No wonder Paul might have said, don't lay your hands on no man suddenly. You got to even be careful down here at the altar who you lay hands on. You think you're trying to pray folks through and they shaking and they quickening and you think it's the Holy Ghost? No, they feeling something else. They're driven. I got to get out of here tonight. Driven by lust. Lust and flesh and worldly desires have taken over their mind. You're not a bad person. Your flesh is just out of control. There's only one way in the natural to help and to solve this problem. When a dog is in heat, they have to be neutered or spayed. To do this process, a doctor goes inside, does what he does, pull the things out that makes them crave for flesh. If you want to get delivered from what you're feeling, you need Dr. Jesus to reach his hand inside of your heart. God help me. Creating me a clean heart and renewing me a right spirit. Somebody got to be honest. God, there's some stuff inside of me. There's some faults. There's some dreams. There's some proclivities that I'm struggling with. I need you to reach your hand of authority and take that mess. out of me. Take it out of me. Watch out. Watch out for those dogs in heat. Stand with me all across the house. Stand with me. Stand with me. Musician, I'm sorry. What song do you play after this? We don't know what direction to go. But seriously, or should I say spiritually, I'm so thankful for the churches that have come. But I'm here at Oneness. I've come to help this church. As you're standing all across the house, I want every individual to come as quick as you can right now. Come as quick as you can. Come gather around this altar. Come as quick as you can. And I want you to begin to enter into a spirit of prayer, a time of worship. I know we laughed a little bit tonight. We had a little fun tonight. But this is serious stuff. Paul warned of these dog-like spirits in the church. And sadly, while some of us laughed at some of the dog-like spirits, the sad thing is that there are some people in the sound of my voice who struggle and fit 1, 2, 3, or maybe all these categories. Through all the laughter tonight, there's people in the sound of my voice that fit these categories, these dog-like spirits. As we talked about this morning about the snake who bit Paul, there's dog-like spirits in the church that have bit saints in the church. And because of that, you're wounded. A pit bull wounded you. A bulldog wounded you. Problem is, don't take it out on God. He didn't do it. And no matter where you go, whether it's New York or the ATL, no matter where you go, no matter what church you go to UPC, go to PAW, go to Cool JC, go to WP, go wherever you want, big church, small church, predominantly black, predominantly white. Guess what? Somebody go bite you. You can't run from a fence. Where you gonna go? Because anywhere people are, anywhere flesh is, somebody's gonna offend you. Somebody's gonna talk to you sideways. Somebody's gonna disrespect you. I'm not belittling that. But what a travesty that we throw down our relationship to God and our allegiance to our local church and our men and women of God because somebody in the church hurt us. You have to understand, church, that God called us to be sheep, not dogs. He called us to be sheep because sheep are submissive. Sheep follow the shepherd. Dogs bark. Don't tell me how to live, preacher. You ain't getting 10% of my paycheck. I ain't dressing like that. Barking, barking, barking. Dogs stray. Dogs wander. Some dogs go to anybody. But sheep only know the voice of the shepherd. And another voice they will not hear. He's called us to be sheep, not dogs. All across this house, this is what I feel tonight. That God wants to give us tonight, not a spirit of praise per se or dance tonight, but he wants to give us a spirit of love and unity and harmony and solidarity. That's what God wants to do. Because revival is birthed out of unity. Look at the book of Acts. Everything that happened because they were unified, one accord, one purpose, one mind. So I want you to link up with somebody while you're standing down here. If they're not too mean, woman to woman. Male to male, if they're not too mean, find somebody, find somebody, find somebody. And I want you to begin to pray. God is getting ready to do something. Hear me, in all of my satire, in all of my comical expression tonight, hear me. God is getting ready to restore and repair broken relationships in here tonight. Hear me. I want you to begin to start praying right now as you're holding that hand right now in the name of Jesus. There's an individual in the sound of my voice right now. You are offended at another department head. You're offended at another leader. And you ain't talked in weeks. You ain't talked in months. Some of you mad at your pastor. Some of you mad at your pastor's wife. You ain't talked to them in weeks. But tonight God is going to restore that relationship. You and another saint, y'all got into it. Y'all had words. And there's been a division. There's been a wall between you and him and you and her. Tonight God is going to bring it back together again. Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it. Begin to pray for unity. Begin to pray for unity. Begin to pray for unity. Come on, that's it. Begin to pray for love. Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it. Come on. I know we're not shouting tonight. I know we're not dancing. I know this is tough. Our flesh don't want this. Our flesh don't want to hear this. I know. But it's good for your soul. Come on, it's good for the body. God, give me unity, God. Unify me with my leadership, God. Unify me with my sister. Unify me with my brother. Come on. Some of you shouldn't leave this house tonight until you get it right with your brother and your sister. Matter of fact, the Bible says, leave your gift at the altar. Don't even preach anymore. Don't even sing anymore until you get it right. How can I stand up here and sing? How can I stand up here and preach? And I got all in my spirit. I can't stand you. God said, get it right tonight. Get it right tonight. Get it right tonight. Get it right tonight. Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it. Come on, brother to brother. Come on. I need somebody to pray. Come on. Sister to sister, pray. Come on, that's it. Fall on your brother, fall on your sister right now. Come on and tell him, I need you. I'm sorry for offending you. I'm sorry for stepping on your toes. I'm sorry for disrespecting the anointing that's on your life. I'm sorry for binding you. I didn't even realize it. I'm sorry. Come on, that's it. I need you to let that hand go and go find somebody else. Come on. Come on, work your faith tonight. Come on, let that hand go. Come on, let that hand go and go find somebody else. Find somebody else. Come on. Find somebody else and pray for them right now in the name of Jesus. Rabakosaka. Come on. Find somebody else and pray with them now. Find somebody else and pray with them. Come on, let a spirit of solidarity hit this house. Let a spirit of unity hit this house. No competition, no jealousy. I need you. You need me. Come on, that's it. I need you, Miguel. I need you, Doreen. I need you, Omar. I need you, Damon. I need you, Kyle. I need you. I need you. I need you. I need you. Come on. Come on. I feel the spirit of the living God in this house. Come on, I feel God mending relationships right now. Come on. I refuse that the devil divide. I refuse that the devil bring division in my house. Come on, that's it. Pray that nasty spirit out of here. Pray that evil spirit out of here. Pray. Come on, that's it. It's time for revival. It's time for the harvest. But we got to get our love right. We have to get our unity right. Come on, young people, that's it. I need your praying, young people. No cliques in the youth group. No division in the youth group. Come on. No schism in the youth group. You're important to me. You're important to me. I can't make it without you. I can't make it without you. I don't want to make it without you.
I pray for you. You pray.
Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it.
I love
you. You ought to find your pastor. You ought to find your pastor's wife tonight. And you ought to lay at their feet and say, whatever I have to do, I'm going to protect you. I'm going to cover you.
I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me.
Come on, this is the last time. Go find somebody else. This is the last time, the third and final time. Go find somebody else. Go find somebody else. This is the third and final time. Go find somebody else. Go find somebody else and pray with them. Fall on them. I need you.
I love
you. I need you
to survive.
Come on, that's it. Find somebody. Find somebody else. I want you in my life. I want you in my life. I want you in my life. I need you in my life.
I pray for you.
You
pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive.
Yes, yes, yes.
I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. It is His will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are I've been changed. pass me by. I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came and changed me. I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came and changed me. Oh, my shame, guilt, sins, forgiven, no more shame.
Back to the way it used to be
for your presence came and changed me. Oh, I won't go back, I can't go back to the way it used to be. Before your presence came and changed me.
Sanctuary.
I won't go back, yeah, I won't go back, I won't go back, I won't go back, yeah, yeah.
Just so you know, I didn't talk to any of the preachers about anything that was happening in here. So I sat back as God began to clean house without me having to. I was getting very frustrated over the last 2-3 weeks. I was turning into an angry preacher. You know, I started to become very concerned for myself because I found myself getting in the same situation that Moses got into, where he did damage to the people. They were wrong, but what he did was even worse because he was in position of authority and was supposed to have reflected completely, entirely the will of God. So I was getting very concerned for myself. There were issues that I didn't think that I could touch, though I needed to touch them. Because the problem is, the preacher knows too much. There are oftentimes people would say, well, it wasn't the word of God, it was just a preacher dumping on me from the pulpit, and that's not what I do. My job is to nurture and take care of you, to build you up, to help you expand your territory. So in one weekend, God has reminded us of what our name is. We are oneness, which is more than just a name. It should be in our action. To those who are oneness, who are in the crowd, who attend this congregation, God gave us promises over the years, and we have not lived up to our promises. We are supposed to be door openers, openers of gates in this city, and we have failed to open up gates. Scripture says in the book of Isaiah that there's a kind of fast that God doesn't want to see. In the midst of your fasting, you're swinging fists at each other. You're biting and devouring one another. Fast, which you get and nobody else gets. God talks about a fast in which we open up our hearts to the defenseless, to the weak, to the poor. As Brother Matt Maddox says, if you take care of the people that God, that nobody wants, God will give you the people that everybody wants. Our mandate is to be servers, people who serve and keep, protectors of our community, protectors of the weak and the poor, the fatherless, the widow. And somewhere we have gotten far, very, very, very far, to the point where I was like, God, is this going to be the generation where we begin to die as a church? I come to church and see decay, spiritual decay. I see your lives decaying. I see spiritual shrinkage. You don't worship like how you used to worship. It now becomes an issue for you to do anything in the house of God. If the pastors ask, we got to twist arms and beg. All of a sudden, it becomes a trial to do, to minister, to open up your... The only time I see you is Sunday mornings. You don't come to Wednesdays. You don't come to family services on Friday. And when I look at your spiritual and financial life, everything is falling apart, and you're not telling me, so I cannot help you. And so my heart is bleeding for you. And I'm hurting for you because I see your end. And then I get frustrated with myself and God and saying, God, maybe I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing as a preacher. And then I begin to question myself. Should I be beating them? Should I take out the word of God and slap them silly and hope that sense comes into their minds? Let us not forget our destiny. And if you're other congregations that are here, New Life, Open Door, so forth, don't forget your destiny. Your individual pastors have a dream for your communities. Oneness, you know the dream for this community. In this last day, why should we sleep? Why should we sit on our hands at the most critical juncture of humanity, where all the clocks of God are swinging to the midnight hour, and we somehow sleep like the foolish virgins? We will not make it. We will not hear the voice. We will not hear the sound of a rapture. So I encourage the saints of oneness, make right. Stop holding your grudges. You weaken the body. When you examine the context of Acts chapter 2, after they received the gift of the Holy Ghost, that initial 120 and the 2,000 plus, what drove